Martha, it sounded like she was being chastised in the gospel, yeah. But she's out there being strong. And with Mary, her sister, you hear later that she was the one that perfumed the Lord. Mm-hmm. She had a major healing. Her brother was Lazarus. So you kind of get an update. And what I like about the inclusion of Martha and Mary so much in the scriptures is exercise. Just like St. Paul, when he mentions at the end of Romans all the people that were helping in that church, one-third of them are women. And he points them out. He names them. And he says, these are key people that have been working here in the church. And so as today's church wants to include women and be very respectful, you can mm-hmm. see it was that way at the start, too.
And they're dear friends of Jesus. I mean, yeah. Jesus stayed in their house. How many people do you know that you actually stay in their house? Those are good friends.
Yeah, they are. Yeah, and so you got to trust that they're going to take care of you.
Beautiful gospel. Mm-hmm. Well, we appreciate the time that you've been able to spend with us on Morning Glory, and we hope that you'll join us again tomorrow. Father Barry, we appreciate you. We'll look forward to seeing you next Tuesday, I hope.
Thank you, yes.
Gloria, you going to be here in the morning?
I will, and I'm hoping some people will tweet out whether or not they want me to join Twitter or not. I'm a little scared to put my foot in the water, so please tweet us at EWTN and tell me yay or nay on joining Twitter.
We do have Sam. He goes by on Twitter, Restrained Freed.
Oh.
And he says, come on, Gloria, it's about that time. He wants to
voice you trust. On air, online, on demand. This is the EWTN Global Catholic Radio Network.
Where else can you laugh and cry, live and learn, pray and encourage? Right here with Mother Angelica. Next time on Mother Angelica Live Classics, Mother challenges your faith as she shares the splendor of truth. Meditating upon Scripture, only on EWTN.
Hi, this is Steve Wood.
This is Father John Trigilio.
This is Teresa Tomeo of Catholic Connection. Thanks for listening to the EWTN Global Catholic Radio Network.
60 Seconds with Mother Angelica.
God created each one of us, but He had in mind, regardless of how we look from childhood to old age, we change physically. But we don't change in His mind. See? Why? Because God has a specific degree of union with Him, holiness we call it, for every one of you. And it's all different. See, we're all different. And we are called to be different because it glorifies God. He just doesn't make robots. Now, why you say, well, why are some holier than others? Well, that's your fault. That's not His fault. If we accept the good, the bad, and the indifferent of every day, we'll all be holy in a different way.
The people you know and trust are on EWTN.
Join the first annual Diocesan Life Fest on Saturday, October 10th at the Catholic Life Center beginning at 10 a.m. This year's theme is Created in God's Image, the Dignity of the Human Person. Keynote speaker is Brian Butler, co-author of Theology of the Body for Teens. Speakers for the breakout sessions will include Father Josh Johnson, David Dawson Jr., Ariel Rowland, Danielle Van Hout, Sarah Denny on a theology of her body, and Adam Fuselier on a theology of his body. There will also be a children's track for ages 5 to 11, music by Greg and Lizzie, Eucharistic Adoration, and the annual Respect Life Mass at 4 p.m., celebrated by Bishop Munch. For more details and to register for this free event, please visit mfldiobr.org. That's mfldiobr.org.
Pray and fast for the unborn. 40daysforlifebr.org. WPYR, 1380 AM, Baton Rouge. CatholicCommunityRadio.org.
Remember, O most gracious Virgin Mary, that never was it known that anyone who fled to your protection, implored your help, or sought your intercession was left unaided. Inspired by this confidence, I fly to you, O Virgin of Virgins, my Mother. To you I come, before you I stand, sinful and sorrowful. O Mother of the Word Incarnate, despise not my petitions, but in your mercy, hear and answer me. Amen.
Wake up. On Catholic Community Radio.
Ah, too good, too true, too holy is our God, and it is a Tuesday, October the 6th. Good to be with you on Catholic Community Radio. It is a gorgeous morning. So glad that you've joined us. I'm Johnny Hebert with Katie Richard this morning.
Good there. To see
you, Katie. And Mr. Jeff Blackwell and Gaby Chauvin.
Good morning.
Yep. Gabby's all toned up from playing kickball last night.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Here comes Pickles.
There's a story there. It's a funny story.
Well, and the Lord be with you all this morning.
Oh, I'm with your spirit, with Johnny. Your spirit,
right. Yes, so you're going to be hearing a lot of that today as Katie's going to really bring us in on the Mass today.
Oh, good.
But you know, let's get our day started off with prayer as everything is rooted in prayer. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Lord God of time and timelessness, you order all things according to your wise designs. Grant us discerning hearts, that we may know and love and serve your plan. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And prayer. We're going to be talking a lot about prayer today because our gospel, Jesus encounters Martha and Mary, right? Two very different personalities, but still saints we can identify with. In fact, sometimes we're both in the same day. We're a Martha one minute, we're a Mary another.
Hey, I got to do all the work around here. What is this?
But, you know, speaking of Martha and being an active person, we have an active person joining us today, right, Gabby?
Well, we have Michael Acaldo calling in at 7:22, so he'll be giving us updates on St. Vincent de Paul and what they're up to. So it's always a pleasure talking with Michael once a month.
And then we're going to have our Mary side because Katie's going to walk us through what does it mean to be at peace in Mass, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Give us a hint.
At peace?
What you're going to talk about today. Because we've been walking through the Mass.
It's very scriptural. That's what I want to say. And a lot of it comes from the way that St. Paul addresses those he's speaking to in his epistles.
Ah, okay.
And so it's there. We're not making it up. And I think it's much better than a howdy or how you doing or good morning.
I love when a Protestant who really knows their Bibles goes to a Mass for the first time. It's like, wait a minute, that's from, you know, this. Mm-hmm. That's from this. That's from this. Those aren't the Mass is so scriptural.
Yep.
Hey, we're remembering today St. Bruno. You know much about St. Bruno?
No.
I just like his name. Hey, Bruno, pray for us.
B-R-U-N-E-A-U-X. No, it's not. You know, he's the Carthusians around the first century. Many people may know about the Carthusians, but they're not very public. You know, they don't like a lot of publicity and stuff like that. Right. So, in fact, this saint, St. Bruno, it was never formally canonized because they didn't want the publicity. Isn't that interesting?
Yeah, that is.
but he is a saint. So, at his feast day today. Anyway, also, we're going to be touching, following up on our Immaculate Misconceptions tied to Katie's presentation today. The question's going to be this.
Yes.
It doesn't really matter when the extraordinary ministers go up onto the altar. So, just to speed things up, they need to hurry up and get up there and break the bread and be there, right? So what's all that timing about? We're going to get into that. There's always something special, right, Katie? You're going to dig into that with us.
Yeah, always something special.
Yeah. So stay with us. We've got stories coming up. Martha, Mary, we have a lot to really cover today. So get your coffee warmed up.
Yep.
Let everybody know. Tell your friends. Call them. Say, hey, tune in, man. It's on right now. Watch us live, streaming video, audio at CatholicCommunityRadio.org. We will be right back with the gospel.
Wake Up Louisiana is brought to you in part by Drs. James Hebert and Jacob Henderson at Central Dental Care on Sullivan Road in Central. Catholic Community Radio thanks Central Dental Care for their support.
Wake Up is underwritten by Berryland Campers with two locations on I-12 in Ponchatoula and I-12 in Holden. Berryland Campers is a proud supporter of Catholic Community Radio. Berrylandcampers.com.
For 2,000 years, we've helped the poor and comforted the sick. We've educated generations of children, developed the scientific method and college system. We support marriage and human life. Guided by the Holy Spirit, we compiled the Bible. We are the Catholic Church, with over 1 billion in our family, sharing in the fullness of Christian faith in the church started by Jesus. If you've been away, visit CatholicsComeHome.org today. Welcome home.
Today's gospel is taken from Luke chapter 10. Jesus entered a village where a woman whose name was Martha welcomed him. She had a sister named Mary who sat beside the Lord at his feet listening to him speak. Martha, burdened with much serving, came to him and said, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me by myself to do the serving? Tell her to help me." The Lord said to her in reply, "Martha, Martha, you are anxious and worried about many things. There is need of only one thing. Mary has chosen the better part, and it will not be taken from her." We've heard the gospel, and now we reflect.
Today's gospel focuses on two saintly women, Martha and Mary, whom Jesus loved dearly. They were sisters in the flesh, but also sisters in spirit, for they gave their hearts to Jesus and were his faithful followers. Mary sat quietly at Jesus' feet, absorbed with the utmost love, reverence, and attentiveness to everything that Jesus said and did. Because she made the better choice, she received the greater benefit. The devoted Martha, in contrast, was anxiously busy preparing a meal for Jesus and the other disciples. She wanted to prepare a fitting supper worthy of her treasured guest. Unfortunately, her anxiety was a distraction because she was more focused on the meal preparation than she was on the words of wisdom. Meanwhile, Mary sat quietly, absorbed in Jesus, oblivious to the whirl of activity in the kitchen. Martha realized that it would be an exercise in futility to draw Mary's attention away from Jesus. So she complained, "Lord, do you not care that my sister has left me by myself to do the serving? Tell her to help me." Mary made no attempt to defend herself. She left that task to Jesus. The Lord addressed Martha affectionately by repeating her name, adding, "You're anxious and worried about many things. There is only one thing necessary. Mary has chosen the better part, and it will not be taken from her." Jesus faulted Martha for surrendering to anxiety that disturbed her spirit and led to her becoming critical. This is an important lesson for us, because we too are often anxious and worried about many things, which is always counterproductive. The key to a Christ-directed life is to interiorly keep in touch with the divine presence that dwells in us. Then we can say with St. Paul, "I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave himself for me. The better part is abiding in that loving relationship. Have a wonderful day. This is Jimmy Sagers.
Thank you, Father Chris Decker. Thank you, Jimmy Sagers. Well, guys, Jimmy's reminding us that, you know, our actions, our efforts, that's not supposed to be the center of our lives or our prayer. The whole point is that God is to be present, and we're to be there for that, you know. And when we get so focused on what we're doing rather than us being, we start to kind of lose focus a little bit, you know. It's like that someone came in and asked their priest, I'm talking about prayer. He says, what's the first thing that I must do to pray? And the priest says, well, first thing is drop the eye, you know. You're focusing so much on what you're doing rather than, you know, focusing on being present. In fact, Father Mark Thibodeau, Jesuit, he in the area, forget in Cajun land, tells lots of stories growing up in the area of Grand Coteau and all that. And he talks about these four stages that you go through. But you can go through these even in the course of a day or even in the course of a prayer time. Yeah. He says the first thing is, you know, you start off talking to God or talking at God. I'm sorry. Talking at him, right? Don't you?
Yes.
Shaking your fist sometime, which is a good start.
You.
And then finally start talking to God and you're moving on. And then finally you start to listen to God. But the real point of it all is the fourth stage, and that is being with God. In fact, he talks about the time when he was a little boy, 8 years old, and he had a nice house, and they ended up building a house out in the country. And they moved to this house, and the little boy started to get so homesick, said Father Thibodeau. He said, about the second or third day, he got so homesick, and he was waiting for his dad to come home. Dad came home, and little dad picked him and said, how you doing? And he goes, I'm okay. This house is kind of scary. And next thing you know, the tears come flooding out. So he starts talking at his dad. Why did you move us? You know, kind of thing. Yeah. And the dad says, well, tell me, what did you like about that old house? And the little boy's crying and sobbing. He starts to tell him all the stories of the things that he did. Mm-hmm. And the dad just listened, you know, to it. And so then the dad started talking to him. He says, well, son, let's talk about what you do today. What do you like about this house? And the boy's mood started to change, Father Thibodeau says. Then I started to say, well, I really like this part of it, and I want to go do this, and I want to go do that. Yeah. And then the next thing you know, the boy just kind of, Father Thibodeau said, he just relaxed in his dad's arms, and his dad just held him in the chair and just listened to his dad's breathing, and all was well. He walked through all four stages. But it really does summarize prayer. That's what it's all about.
I have to do a little plug. There's actually a beautiful book of prayer based upon this gospel. It's called The Better Part. It's written by an Opus Dei priest named Father Bartunek. And I just started kind of rereading it. Like the latter half, it has all the gospels and has meditation. But the first part, which I kind of just stupidly skipped over, is this beautiful guidance about how, like, what is prayer? How are you to pray? And about, you know, the essential of meditation, how meditation is essential to prayer. And that's where I think where Mary in this gospel, where we have to draw from, because she's sitting at our Lord's feet listening. And that's what meditation is. It's us sitting and listening to words of Christ, listening to what the Lord has to say to us. Because yes, like vocal prayer is good, reciting rosaries and other prayers that come to mind, but meditation is necessary because it's the window where God is allowed to speak to us.
As compared, you know, Martha's running around, the center of Martha's world is what she was doing. You know, in a sense, you kind of get this feel like, look what I'm doing, look what I'm doing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's all good stuff, and it's all about the Lord's there, but what's at the center there, you know, what she's doing? Well, Mary takes the better part. I mean, for a woman of that day and time to be able to sit at the feet of a rabbi like that was unheard of. And this, again, shows Jesus' elevation of women of all time, but also that how he's going to elevate us. As we humble ourselves to listen, he will raise us up. And she's just in rapture. What a beautiful model for us. And, of course, we know the active life is important. It's later that Martha says, even now, Lord, I know you will raise my brother Lazarus. She calls upon him. So that's important for us to be balanced in that sense, right?
Absolutely.
Are we going to be a Martha today or a Mary today? Hey, maybe there's an appropriate time to be one or the other. But in the end, what's at the center of anything and everything we do but the loving and living God that animates our activities today?
That's right. Wow. Well, weather-wise, it's going to be nice, long, dry stretch of weather ahead and kind of carbon copy. We'll use the same forecast for the next 4 or 5 days. Partly sunny during the day, warm and dry through Sunday, highs in the upper 80s, partly cloudy nights with the lows near 70. And that's the weather. Hey, we got the saint of the day coming up next. It is now 7:15 on Wake Up.
What's in a name? Barry Land Campers offers RVs, fifth wheels, and motor coaches with names recognized in the industry. Cardinal, Flagstaff, Cherokee, Puma, and others. Over 30 acres of RVs and hundreds of makes and models. Sales and service personnel have the experience to help you. Barry Land Campers with two locations on I-12 in Ponchatoula and I-12 in Holden. Barry Land Campers is a proud underwriter of Catholic Community Radio. On the web at barrylandcampers.com.
Would you like to deepen your prayer life and grow in your relationship with Jesus?
If so, Lord Teach Me to Pray is for you. Lord Teach Me to Pray is a prayer series based on the spiritual exercises of St. Ignatius of Loyola.
Groups are forming now.
Go to LordTeachMeToPray.com and click on Schedules to select a group and register.
Don't pass up this opportunity to come and truly know and love Jesus through Ignatian prayer.
Go to LordTeachMeToPray.com today.
And click on Schedules to select a group and register.
This is Saint of the Day for October 6th from the Franciscans and St. Anthony Messenger Press. Today we celebrate St. Bruno. Many saints founded religious orders, and many others helped to reform them. Today's saint has the distinction of founding a religious order that never had to be reformed, because it was never deformed. Bruno was born in Cologne, Germany, around the year 1030. He became a famous teacher and served as chancellor of its archdiocese. His dream, however, was to live in solitude and prayer. He persuaded a few friends to join him in a hermitage. After a time, he was given a more remote, solitary site on which to build. There, Bruno and his friends built an oratory with small individual cells at a distance from each other. The year was 1084, the beginning of the Carthusians, a contemplative monastic order. 6 years later, Pope Urban II called Bruno to Rome for a consultation about church affairs. When Pope Urban fled because of anti-papal activity, Bruno also pulled up stakes. He spent his last years in the wilderness of southern Italy. Bruno was never formally canonized. The Carthusians resisted publicity. Pope Leo X simply declared Bruno a saint in 1514. There's more about the saints, along with inspiration and Catholic resources, at our website, franciscanradio.org. From the Franciscans and St. Anthony Messenger Press, this is Saint of the Day.
Hey, Bruno, you're a saint. That's right. St. Bruno, pray for us.
Pray for us, amen.
18 minutes after 7 o'clock here on Catholic Community Radio. Wake up! We've got Gaby Chauvin in Master Control, Katie Richard here, just sandwiched in between Johnny Hebert, and I'm Jeff Blackwell. Hey, it's good to have you here with us.
Well, it's a big week, because the synod is going on overseas on the family. Oh, right, Gabby?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. What else is happening in Vatican and world news?
Well, we have a lot of news today, but we're going to focus mainly on the United States today. California governor signs an assisted suicide bill yesterday. Jerry Brown now gives doctors permission to prescribe pills to patients who wish to end their lives. Californians Against Suicide says this is an eerie day for the state. Doctors give the drugs to terminally ill patients, but the legislation will not go into effect until 2016. Catholic leaders say this is a violation of human life. Those for the legislation say this is a way to help terminally ill patients to end pain they have been suffering for a long time.
Well, this is
think that this decision is something that each American should have the right and the opportunity to make for themselves. So we will continue to do this work in the states, but we are also working on the national level.
This is the fifth state allowing assisted suicide. So I also have, what's it like when Pope Francis visits the homeless? And this shows how he's really humble. Homeless men and women say their lives will be forever changed with the presence of God when Pope Francis came to visit them. bishops with the Holy Father say he treated the crowds of Washington, D.C. the same as those living on the streets when he saw them, that is, with love and dignity. He says, saying, quote, "The Son of God came into the world as a homeless person." He wants to make sure the citizens of the U.S. do not forget those who are homeless. Monsignor Elzer says Pope Francis desires to be closer with the crowd and spoke to less than 100 people while he was in Washington, D.C. and touring. And when he did speak to them, he was engaged in full conversation.
You know, the Pope kind of kicked off that synod. And I love one thing. It kind of fits in with this whole visit here. He's told the synod, don't politicize things. He said the synod's not a conference or a parlor, nor is it parliament or a senate where we come to an agreement. Rather, the church journeying together to interpret reality with the eyes of faith and the heart of God. There was one quote, though, he actually, it's a quote from John Paul II that he invoked. Katie, you're going to like this.
Okay.
He said, re-quoting John Paul II in 1978, the Pope recalled this. He said, "Error and evil must always be condemned and opposed, but the man who falls or who errs must be understood and loved." See how those two things go hand in hand? Mm. Love the sinner, hate the sin?
That's
tying them down.
Yeah.
Well, on this day in history.
Yes, what happened?
Well, let's talk about in the year 1826, there was a publication that went out for a lost little boy for 1 cent, a reward for 1 cent to find the little child who wandered away out in Nevada. Turned out that was Kit Carson. Never was found. Ended up going on to a life, as I'm sure many people know about, the famous Kit Carson of the Wild West. What you don't know about Kit Carson is that his first wife died. His second wife left him. He finally met the woman of his dreams. They had 8 children together. Wow. Ended up becoming a devout Catholic.
Really?
And doing many great things with his life.
Kit Carson the Catholic.
And in 1890, the Mormon Church outlaws polygamy. So they will now likely be called bigoted polyphobes? Is that what we're going to be? I don't know. And in 1939, Adolf Hitler denies he intends to go to war against France and Britain and then announces plans to regulate the Jewish problem. I wonder if someone one day will record the day that Iran said the same thing about exterminating the Israel problem being on the map, or the day the Freedom From Religion group said that about Christians being a problem in the public square. I wonder. Just ask.
Or the unborn being.
There you go.
Oh, my word. We got them started now, Gaby.
Yeah, and let's remember to do. Today, Opus Dei founder Jose Maria Escariva was canonized on this day in 2002. Awesome. Yes, Katie?
No, I was just picking off a thread on your shirt.
Well, we're going to turn to talking about being a contemplative in action. That's what's happening on the streets all around St. Vincent, wherever St. Vincent de Paul is.
It is 7:22 now on Wake Up.
Here's how to connect with CCR via social media. Get Catholic Community Radio on your smartphone or tablet 24/7 by downloading the free TuneIn app and listen on the go. Make a prayer request, donate, or listen online at CatholicCommunityRadio.org. Send us a tweet at Radio Catholic. Shoot us an email to wakeup@CatholicCommunityRadio.org. And like us on Facebook at Catholic Community Radio.
Good to be with you at 7:23 on Catholic Community Radio. We are talking about taking our prayer and putting it feet on it. Well, who does that all over South Louisiana?
Every day.
St. Vincent de Paul and all its volunteers doing great things for the name of God. And we're always excited to have Michael Acaldo on with us this morning. Michael, how you doing?
We're doing great. How are y'all doing?
Man, we're doing fine. You know, it's the fall weather is upon us. The seasons change. But one thing that never changes is the needs that are out there. So what's St. Vincent de Paul, being called to do these days?
Well, I think, you know, our mission is to follow what our Holy Father urged us all to do in his visit. Which is to seek and find the forgotten and the suffering and those who are deprived in our community and try to give them a compassionate hand up. And that's what we do at St. Vincent de Paul all the time. And we just got word at the beginning of this week that the Louisiana Association of Nonprofit Organizations has named the Society of St. Vincent de Paul Baton Rouge chapter as the nonprofit of the year state of Louisiana.
So, my goodness.
Now, isn't that fantastic that the work and the people we are so blessed to serve were recognized with that honor? And it's it really says a lot about what we do. And one of the things that we are we do every October is our Sweet Dreams effort. Our Sweet Dreams effort encourages people throughout our diocese to pray for the women and children, homeless women and children we serve at our Bishop Hot Sweet Dreams shelter. And we encourage everyone to get a hold of our prayer card. They're available at our office. And I will email y'all a copy so that y'all can maybe put it on the website or throw it up on the website there. And people can go directly to your website, take a peek at it, and pray a wonderful prayer that encourages not only us to enrich in our spiritual life, but hopefully have bring Christ into the lives of people who truly need the help and the help that they so desperately need.
Yeah, we'll definitely take that prayer card. We'll post that up.
Okay.
And Michael, I always like to, maybe we can put that on Facebook, huh?
Yeah.
Gabby's good about that. So one of the things that, that's been ongoing here is a fundraising effort to expand the, is it the Sweet Dream Shelter?
Yes, that's another thing that we have going as well.
Okay.
And it is an effort that is underway right now, and we've only got about $98,000 left. We've raised over, right over $700,000. We've got another $98,000 to go. And once we hit that, we can do what's necessary to get all the final construction documents together and go out to bid, and then begin constructing an expansion of our shelter that brings us from 36 beds to over 70. Because we're really struggling to find enough room for women and children that come to us in need.
Another thing, my wife and I were going through some boxes, and we have, you know, some things that are nice we don't want to really throw away. And I know that St. Vincent de Paul has stores all around the capital area. How do we go about getting, like, if we're, you know, cleaning out things that are just too good to toss out?
We want every one of those items. Obviously, if it's a small bag of clothes or just a small box of items, if people could drop them by our thrift stores, you know, throughout the diocese, we would encourage you to do so. You know, there are St. Vincent de Paul stores all over the country. New Orleans has several. Yeah. Homotipide Diocese has a St. Vincent de Paul thrift store. So very rich history in Louisiana of us taking items. And a lot of people don't realize that we have a program where people in need of those items, whether it's clothing or shoes or you know, a warm coat for the winter, blankets,
blankets, sure.
All those items are given away free to people in need. We have individuals in St. Vincent de Paul conferences and church parishes that go out and they make home visits. They sure that they see what the needs are, and then they send them to our thrift store if they have needs. And we fill those needs free of charge for people who desperately need those items. And if people have furniture or larger pickups, we have a truck, and we can send that out. And it's easy. Give us a call, and we'll be glad to make that pickup.
And what is that phone number, Michael?
That number is 267 and then give. 267 give 225 267 give.
Wow. There you go. And you're also on the web as well, right?
Yes, exactly right. SVDPBR.org. And again, the Louisiana Association of Nonprofit Organizations named us Nonprofit of the Year.
That's
and, cool. Of course, this we talked about this when I've been on. This is our 150th year in the Baton Rouge community.
Marvelous work, Michael. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you all so much for letting people know what we're doing.
All right, God bless you, brother.
Nonprofit for the profit, PHM.
I love that.
What are the do's and don'ts for extraordinary ministers during Mass? Mm-hmm. We'll talk about that in 21 minutes with Ms. Katie Richard. It's now 7:30 on Wake Up.
St. Mary's Books and Gifts, the little bookstore with a big heart and a thirsting desire to spread the good news. 225-272-4030. Laura Mandeville Kransky of St. Mary's Books and Gifts is a longtime supporter of Catholic Community Radio. St. Mary's Books and Gifts, located on the corner of Florida and Sherwood Forest Boulevard, 225-272-4030. St. Mary's Books and Gifts.
This is a Young Catholic Minute.
So, why does the kind of music I listen to matter?
As Bob Dylan says in his song, "It's All Right, Ma, I'm Only Bleeding," he not being busy born is busy dying. And essentially that's true for our Catholic life as well. Every choice we make brings us closer or further from God. This includes our choice of music. Remember that music as an art form reflects the artist and connects with listeners because they identify with it. And although we all can identify with sin, deep down inside we identify with the truth and the light of Christ even more. This doesn't mean that we can only listen to Gregorian chant. Remember, the very fact that we can sing or play music is a glorious gift from the Lord, which means we only have to start being careful when the music we listen to contradicts God and exalts things which can only identify with our sinful nature, things like drugs, lust, and anger. And when in doubt about a song, just ask yourself, what would Jesus listen to? For more, youtube.com/youngcatholic.
At Woman's New Life Center, we know that every woman's story and needs are unique. That's why we provide the best professional, individualized care for all women. Whether you are needing guidance during a time of crisis, experiencing an unplanned pregnancy, struggling with a past abortion, seeking authentic health care, or discovering the beauty of fertility, Woman's New Life Center is here for you. Experience hope. Visit womansnewlife.com.
Join the first annual Diocesan Life Fest on Saturday, October 10th at the Catholic Life Center beginning at 10 a.m. This year's theme is Created in God's Image, the Dignity of the Human Person. Keynote speaker is Brian Butler, co-author of Theology of the Body for Teens. Speakers for the breakout sessions will include Father Josh Johnson, David Dawson Jr., Ariel Rowland, Danielle Van Hout, Sarah Denny on a theology of her body, and Adam Fuselier on a theology of his body. There will also be a children's track for ages 5 to 11, music by Greg and Lizzie, Eucharistic Adoration, and the annual Respect Life Mass at 4 p.m., celebrated by Bishop Munch. For more details and to register for this free event, please visit mfldiobr.org. That's mfldiobr.org.
This is Life News Radio. I'm Jim Anderson. Governor Jerry Brown signed the assisted suicide bill Monday, and California will now indeed become the fourth state to remove protections relied upon by citizens from the beginning of law itself. Euthanasia can be called assisted suicide, and that may be described as an obligation to die. Families interested in preserving their inheritance, states interested in saving money on medical care, and societies which only wish to see superficial beauty and wholeness all have Oregon, Washington, Vermont, and now California to thank, as that obligation may now legally be offered to marginalized persons. Cecile Richardson and Carly Fiorina are exchanging jabs. The Planned Parenthood president called Fiorina a liar after Fiorina helped expose the sale of abortions turned into specimens. And presidential candidate Fiorina says Richardson should resign for presiding over such perverse practices. This is Life News Radio.
Do you want your daughter to grow up in a world that teaches her
that the responsible thing to do is to suppress and destroy the natural functions of her body? We don't. We want all our daughters to see their bodies as perfectly made and their abilities to bear and sustain new life as a precious gift to society. Join us in empowering our girls to embrace their femininity. Lighting the way to a culture of life. TheGuidingStarProject.com.
A Thursday hearing this week in Congress will delve into the illegalities in selling abortion specimens. And more investigative video shows Texas doctor and abortionist Amna Dermish not only wishing to hone her abortion skills, but also touting her abilities in performing later-term abortions and describing abortion in graphically honest language. This has been Life News Radio.
It is 7:35 here on Catholic Community Radio at Wake Up. Katie Richard, along with Johnny Hebert, Gaby Chauvin. I'm Jeff Blackwell with you on this Tuesday morning, October 6th. And what a lovely day it is. Yes. It's going to be just nice and dry here for the rest of the week.
We are learning how to speak less, to laugh more, and to listen the most. Mm. That's our goal today.
What'd you say?
I do need to make one correction. I talked about a book that's...
Now, wait a minute. You...
Yes, I make mistakes, Jeff. I talked about a book by Father John Bartunek. He is not an Opus Dei. He's a Legionary of Christ, or as other people may hear, Regnum Christi. So Legionaries, Opus Dei, separate, both great. But Father John Bartunek, if you're looking for that book, it's called The Better Part, and he is a Legionary of Christ.
Ding! There it is.
And I was quoting the stories I was talking about is in a book by Father Mark E. Thibodeau, locally, and the book is called Armchair Mystic. Many stories about Cajun life and peace. In fact, as we kind of go into one of the stories, Katie, he tells, ties into your idea of may peace be with you. You know, and it had to do with an old church growing up out there in the Eunice area, I guess it was, and they didn't have a bell. They didn't have enough money for a bell. So people just kind of guessed about what time it was for Mass. And they'd get there kind of early because they weren't sure. And as they stood around waiting for Mass to begin, they would talk to one another and catch up on what's happening in their families and even settle old conflicts and things like that and talk about problems with this tract or whatever. And finally the priest would come and they'd go in the Mass. Well, that was a really tight-knit community till they got the bell. And then they got the bell and everybody would wait and then rush in. Kind of missed the whole point of being at peace with one another before we come in and make our gifts at the altar. And that's kind of where we are right now. We're at the sign of peace. Is it, where are we today in the Mass?
No, we are coming right after the sign of the cross. And the greeting that comes from the priest. And he, you know, he says, "The Lord be with you." And that's taken from sacred scripture, which is found in the epistles of St. Paul, if you kind of recall the numerous ways that he addresses people in his letter. And you'll kind of recognize it when I go through, you know, there are three different options that the priest can use. The first is very simple, and he just says, "The Lord be with you." He also has another option that comes from 2 Corinthians 13:14, almost verbatim, and it says, "The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you."
And you say,
And with your spirit.
Right.
And the third option is grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's found several times in 1 and 2 Corinthians, Galatians, pretty much in any letter of St. Paul. He uses this suggestion.
I don't think I hear it. Have you guys heard that one much, that option? I don't know that I've heard that one that
much. I hear different variations.
I did not know he had those options.
Yeah, he has those options. But there's one that the priest does not have an option that is only allowed to the bishop, and that is to say, "Peace be with you."
Really?
Only the bishop is allowed to say that in the opening of the Mass because it's by virtue of his office, and it's recalling the inaugural words that our Lord uses in his resurrection. To his apostles after his resurrection, he says, "Peace be with you." So that is only the privilege of the bishop, you know, in those up.
Yeah, because the Lord said that to his apostles, and the bishops are the successors. Mm-hmm. Right. Okay.
Yeah. So, you know, I wish I would have talked about this before getting into this greeting, but the kiss of the altar, maybe we can come back to it, but the greeting follows this, and why does that matter? And it's because, you know, the priest bows down before the altar and he kisses the altar. And I have to quote it here. It says, The priest bows down before the altar because he who wishes to communicate a benediction unto others must first of all, by his humility, include heaven to bestow the blessing which he desires to impart. So he kisses the altar, he reverences our Lord to receive what he wishes to bestow on us. But that's why it comes after the kissing of the altar, because he needs our Lord to pass it on to us.
Oh, okay. Kisses the altar. Then he says, mm-hmm. the Lord be with you. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah. And it's actually, you know, the Lord be with you and all these other, you know, greetings. It, mm-hmm. it was an ancient form of a greeting that expressed good wish. You know, for whoever has the Lord with them, you know, we want that upon others. That it's the greatest gift that our church wants for her children, to have the Lord be with her children. Mm. And we can see this all through, you know, through the Bible. If we think about, you know, Moses, when the Lord tells Moses to take his people from Egypt, or the angel Gabriel talking to Mary, he says, first, you know, the Lord be with, you know, the Lord is with you, that he is there, and he is in your heart, and he's in your soul. And it's necessary too. Not only do we need to know that, but it's necessary, because it's a reminder that God is with us, a plea for his divine grace, but also that we're going to need the Lord with us for what we're about ready to partake in. That wow. priest is giving us the Lord, that he says that the Lord may be with you, because we're about ready to enter the Mass, and we need that grace to be able to pray through the
yes,
Mass.
Yes, yes.
I like it, because when he says it, I may not recognize that the Lord is with me, but when he says it, this is, okay, he is. He's making a declaratory statement too,
right.
in a sense.
Yeah. I mean, if you just sit back and you think about it, if somebody said, you know, the Lord be with you, whoa. Like, and that actually happens in the Eucharist, that we consume and the Lord is with us, but he's even there beforehand. He's given through the Holy Spirit so that
yes,
we can continue
right.
through the Mass. And so why is our response important?
Yeah, and with your spirit, not and with you, but and
right,
with
and
your
with your spirit.
What's
and,
that?
Well, the change happened, you know, if we remember that we also said, and also with you.
Right.
But
yes.
that spirit, that word, it's so important. And this new translation of, you know, and with your spirit is actually, it's a more literal translation of the traditional Latin form. And St. Paul, you know, uses this in Galatians and Timothy, again, in all his letters. You know, he says, and with your spirit, he hones in on that word. And if you think about it, it's kind of signifies this close relationship between the priest and the people. The priest is saying, the Lord be with you. And we are responding saying, and with your spirit. Like, we want the Lord to be with your spirit mm-hmm. because you're about ready to offer the sacrifice of Mass. You're about ready to pray on our behalf. So we want the Lord to be with you. Mm. And not only just with you in body, but within your spirit, persona Christi, that you can offer this sacrifice for us.
That's kind of cool. So we, who are the priesthood of all believers, but yet are connected to the priest who's actually in persona of Christ. That's a mm-hmm. connection there, just with that exchange. That's kind of neat.
Yeah, I want to read two of these quotes. I'll have to get like a bibliography for y'all of all the books that I use. But the first one says, it's kind of defining, like, what do we say when we say, and with your spirit? It says, may the Lord be with your spirit, O shepherd of our souls, for you pray for us and teach us the way of life eternal. Therefore, does your spirit need the Lord to be near? That's the first quote in this.
Wow.
May the Lord be with your soul, in your mind, and in your heart. Because this divine work is chiefly spiritual and refers to the soul, therefore it is petitioned that the Lord filled the soul of the priest with the abundant graces.
And you're reading, that's from what? The Heart of the Mass?
One is from the Heart of the Mass, and one is actually called the Latin Mass Explained. And it's still acceptable to take things that we learn from the Latin Mass because they still apply to the Novus Ordo, the Mass that we celebrate today. My favorite part that I've read, and this is actually another one, is from a book from Mark Hart called Understanding, A Deeper Understanding of the Catholic Mass. And he says, when you use the word spirit, you are referring to the very core of who that person is. Because if we remember that we are not just a body, we are a body and soul unit.
Right.
And the soul comes from our Lord. And so we want to say, and with your spirit, that we are talking to the core of that person that makes them who they are and makes them fully alive in Christ. And another great point when you say that, you know, and with your spirit, try to pray for your priest as you're saying that, you know, that you pray that not only that the Lord may be with him, but that he may offer the sacrifice purely and charitably and lovingly because he's doing it on your behalf. That is his role, to offer the Mass on our behalf, to offer the sacrifice to our Lord. And so we have a great, great gift to be able to stop and pray for that priest and say, with your spirit, like, oh Lord, bless him. Bring your spirit upon him, that as he stands as in persona Christi to offer this sacrifice, that he, our sacrifice may be made worthy through him, with your spirit
I really love that, because it also wraps up, you know, John chapter 6, the bread of life discourse, and this is how it ends. You know, all, it's only through the spirit in which we can understand that what we're about to do with our bodies, and we eat his flesh and drink his blood, but it's through the spirit that this is really understood.
Yes.
And it's through the priest that we get that gift to even more understand.
I love that. Just simple exchange. Mm-hmm. All that going on with us.
And it's the first verbal exchange in the entire Mass.
Ah.
That's true. That is true. All right. Wonderful. Well, I can't wait till next week now. Keep them coming, Katie. Hey, weather-wise, we're looking for partly sunny skies today. Look for a high in the mid-80s, maybe upper 80s, then partly cloudy tonight, low near 70. We've got more ahead, and Katie has a question for Johnny. It's 7:45 on Wake Up.
This Marriage Minute is brought to you by the Wilwoods community, rooted in prayer, united in service.
Marriage is the most fundamental building block of society. If marriage goes, so goes the family, and so goes the society in which we live. Marriage has such an impact that Blessed John Paul II wrote that the future of the church passes through the family. With all the attacks that marriage is undergoing, inside and out, it demands that all of us must come to a deeper understanding of what marriage is and defend it. At its most basic definition, marriage is an intimate, exclusive, and indissoluble union of man and woman at the call of the Creator for the good of the spouses and the procreation and the education of children. And in the baptized, this giving over of one to the other is a sacrament which signifies the union of Christ and the church and gives grace to the spouses to love each other as Christ loves, thus leading the couple and the family closer to heaven.
For more information on strengthening your marriage, call 504-830-3716 or check us out on the web at faithandmarriage.org.
I'm Gaby Chauvin with your community calendar update. Come pray for America and religious freedom with the 2015 Public Square Rosary Crusade on Saturday, October 10th at noon at St. Isidore Catholic Church in Baker. Contact Thelma King at 225-774-0929. Come join the fun at the St. George Fair on Saturday, October 10th and Sunday, October 11th. Advanced ride bracelets are on sale. Go to stgeorgefair.com for the fair layout and more information. And come pray to end abortion by signing up for 40 Days for Life at your local church parish or go online at 40daysforlife.com. Send us your church announcements at least 2 weeks in advance to events@catholiccommunityradio.org. I'm Gaby Chauvin with your community calendar update.
Oh, when we gaze upon God, we see the entire world to enter his eyes. Good to be with you on Catholic Community Radio. We are streaming live in video and audio. So tell your friends, tell your family to tune in to CatholicCommunityRadio.org, 690 in the Southeast Louisiana.
If you really want to see what it's like visually to wake up early in the morning.
It will wake you up.
No. You turn on the video and you're like, ooh, yeah.
I feel better about myself now.
Oh, yeah. Gabby really makes us look really good.
No. You watching us, you'd be like, okay. Well, I do have some announcements.
Yes.
You just heard a couple earlier. But Sister Dulcie hosts a men's spirituality class on Wednesday, October 7th. That's tomorrow.
Yeah.
At 7 o'clock a.m. at the Chapel of Divine Providence in Baton Rouge. Coffee and fellowship begins at 6:30 a.m. in the Dolphin Room. And the 25th annual New Orleans Rosary Congress is on. It started Saturday, October 3rd, but it runs through this Friday, October 9th, at St. Clement of Rome in Metairie. Call 504-508-7100 or go to rosarycongress.org. And the 11th anniversary Mass with Archbishop Amon is being held this Sunday, October 11th, at St. Francis of Xavier in Metairie. Reception is immediately to follow. And in local Baton Rouge news, Most Blessed Sacrament is having an outdoor Mass and parish picnic on Sunday, October 18th at 11:30 a.m. Mass. at 11:30 a.m. Bring your own blanket, lawn chair, and lunch. After Mass, there will be a live band, face painting, and games for the kids. Visit mbsparish.org for more information.
Face painting is not just for kids.
Katie's like, I will be in line.
Voice of experience.
Paint
there.
With your face. Anyway.
No. Adult painting, adult painting of face is called makeup.
Oh, wait, I just got it.
Gabby, you hit that story earlier about out in California. Man, what is it about California? I don't know, man. This is crazy. I mean, they follow these examples of what's happening here. And we're talking about how, you know, Jerry Brown just signed this into the law, a bill enabling doctors to prescribe drugs that will end the lives of so-called terminally ill. We see this happening in Europe about how this. It's not even a slippery slope. It happened really quickly where with the healthcare costs and all this stuff, now pretty much anybody, you know, you're not producing, nobody loves you, we think the best thing for you will be just
I feel like it's going to have to be, you know, if you do not want to be killed by a doctor, you have to put that in your will now. I feel like that shouldn't
It's a culture of death.
It shouldn't really be happen to be a thing. By the way, please do not kill me, da-da-da-da, like.
Well, you know, I love the fact that the Catholic voices are still standing, and we're consistent in our defense of life from, you know, natural conception to natural death. So let's continue to pray and stand up and speak.
And even Governor Brown said that he knew there were some religious, you know, implications that he thought about those things that went into his decision, but he decided, it's just better to put people out of their misery. Anyway.
Yeah, right. Well,
we could talk all day about that.
You know, we are going to get back to the Mass here with our Immaculate Misconception. I'm going to ask the question to Katie this time around.
Oh, okay. It's 7:51 on Wake Up.
And now, as an apologetics public service, Wake Up proudly presents Immaculate Misconceptions.
Okay, Katie.
Sir.
You know how you know, you're getting
ready to... getting all Cajun, sir.
You know how you... All right, Katie. Am I really? Oh, shit.
We got the giggles this morning.
Okay, so we're waiting...
It's the coffee with Lewis. <and you. laughs>
Right. We're waiting for communion, and we have what we call extraordinary ministers. They're getting ready to go up the altar before the priest receives communion. But sometimes they go right up there before the priest has even done kind of his thing. And sometimes they stand away. And I don't understand all that. Someone's asking the question, actually, this was put into Catholic Answers. What's the deal here? You know, what are extraordinary ministers? And what's supposed to be their process in terms of, walking up to the altar and receiving.
Yeah.
I think we need to go back to the importance of the sanctuary and the importance of what the priest is, who he is, and what he is doing. And we talked about the sanctuary, both in architecture and in the procession, that the sanctuary is a place for the ordained, a place for the priest, for those who are persona Christi or those in training to be. And that, you know, the priest is ordained for this, you know, for these sacraments and, you know, to give us the Mass specifically.
Right.
His hands are ordained to hold the body and blood of Christ. And I think we need to remember that when we think about extraordinary ministers of Holy Communion, that, you know, are we ordained for this ministry or not? Mm. And our priest, first and foremost, is. Now, there is the, we began to allow extraordinary ministers for... you know, if there was just too many, but it was only supposed to be in necessity, only in necessity.
If like there's too many people, you don't have enough priests there.
And I want to go back there in the Latin Mass, actually, when you would go up to communion and you would sit at the altar rail, priests were allowed to, you know, you had your main celebrant, but they could come with their stole on and they would help pass out communion. But you know, an absolute necessity, if you are an extraordinary minister of Holy Communion, you have to take it very, very seriously. And, you know, think of, okay, am I supposed to go up while the priest is still partaking of our Lord? Am I supposed to be in the sanctuary where he who was ordained is always supposed to be.
Yeah, because the germ, the Roman Missal, it's pretty clear about this, right? That talk about that, what the Eucharistic extraordinary ministers should and shouldn't do before the priest actually receives
the
Lord.
I'm going to quote the germ here. It's germ, I think it's paragraph 162. It says, quote, in case of necessity, the priest may depute suitable faithful for this single occasion. These ministers should not approach the altar before the priest has received communion, and they are always to receive from the hands of the priest celebrant the vessel containing either species of the most holy Eucharist for distribution of the faithful. They are not to go up and take the chalice. They are not to go up and take the sporium or wherever the host is. They are to be given it.
And they're not to go up until the priest receives.
First, not until the priest receives Holy Communion. And second of all, they are not to receive communion from anybody else, any other extraordinary minister, but to only get it from the hands of the priest. And then be given what they are supposed to be given out.
Yeah, from what I understand, the germ talks about the point is to make sure that we don't add confusion. I mean, who is standing in persona of Christ? Who is consecrated and who is not?
Right.
If we go against this, it just kind of sows all kind of confusion.
It does. And also look, you know, at the care that is taken of both species, especially of the Eucharist.
Yes.
The care that the priest has. In the extraordinary form, they would take the thumb and the pointer finger, and once they consecrated the host, they would keep those together because those were the fingers that touched the Lord. And every spectacle is Christ. And so they would keep those hands together so as to not drop Christ. Well, if you're thinking of just a lay person who's handing out communion, he or she too is holding the body and blood of Christ, but it's the same respect being taken that the priest does. He cleanses his hands after he distributes communion. He pours water over it.
Yeah. But,
and if you think about it, where is our Lord?
Mm.
Like, is the care being taken of our Lord, or the proper steps being taken to where he's not being defiled?
Wow, that's a lot to really digest. That's powerful stuff. Thanks, Katie.
Beautiful stuff.
You're welcome. Wow. Well, let's stay with us tomorrow. Who's our guest tomorrow, Gabby?
Yeah.
Well, tomorrow we have Sister Tracy coming on and Peter Finney. Still waiting to hear back from Dr. Italy. I'm pretty sure he'll be on tomorrow. So looking forward to seeing what we're going
all
to.
All right. Well, we're always excited to have Sister Tracy Dugas with us. Such a vessel of joy.
Yeah.
In our fresh celebration of 100 years of them being established. So.
Yes.
Well, let's call upon St. Bruno to pray for us today as we pray in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. O God, who called St. Bruno to serve you in solitude, grant through his intercession that amid the changes of this world, we may constantly look to you alone through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. In the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen. Remember, let's meditate on Martha and Mary today. And remember, wisdom begins when words fail and the awe sets in. Let's be in awe of our Lord today. Have a great day, everybody. We'll see you back same place, same time tomorrow.
God bless. Wake Up is a production of Catholic Community Radio.
Lord Wellington and